Knock, knock, knock.
Good morning. Oh, wait, there's a net here.
Oh,
how do I? Which zipper? There's so many zippers here. Hold on. Welcome to my crib. I just decided to move into my trunk. It's honestly pretty comfortable in here. I mean, I have this Sony A7S III here, which I guess is pretty cool. But you know what's cooler is this air mattress.
Like, look at this. Isn't this awesome? It has a little cutout for the wheel wells and everything.
Talk about this.
Oh, fine. So check this out. This is the Sony A7S Mark III. The camera that we've been waiting for what, 5 years now? And was it worth the wait? Fuck yeah. Let's just start with this. Huh? Flip screen. Boom. For me, I film myself a lot for YouTube and when I'm vlogging. So being able to do this is huge. Also, another complaint I've always had was the color science. That's been greatly improved. And we have 10-bit 422. And when you're shooting 4K 60 frames per second, you're getting 600 megabits per second. We're talking about getting a professional codec and file out of this little camera. So here's a shot of Sam here. Hello, Sam.
You said I wasn't gonna be working today.
I kind of tricked Sam into being like, hey, you wanna come on a camping trip? But really it means like, hey, you wanna do free work for me?
I flew my girlfriend in from Georgia.
And I'm working.
Hi, Crystal. See, she seems fine. She actually seems to be enjoying it more now that you're occupied. The 10-bit with a decent bit rate was the most important thing for me. So right now I'm shooting 4K 10-bit 422 at 24 frames per second. And at that frame rate, I'm getting about 240 megabits per second. That's a lot of numbers, but basically that means I feel comfortable using S-Log 3 on this camera. And that's awesome because that's the same color profile we're using on this Sony FX9. And that's awesome. Sony's always had S-Log 3 in their mirrorless cameras, but I never touched it because first of all, it's 8-bit. And also I always had issues matching it. The colors weren't there 100%. But on this A7S Mark III, they've made a big push to make the S-Log 3 from here match their professional cameras. Oh, sorry, I still have some stickers on this. Sony told me that I'm not allowed to show anyone this camera until the embargo lifts or else they'll kill me in my sleep. But hey, Jonathan, you've signed an NDA, right?
No.
I rolled it up in your tent and left it right there.
Sam, I was like, you know what to do. Now, when I'm looking for the perfect mirrorless camera, I want it to do two functions really well. One, I want it to be convenient and flexible enough to be used as a vlog camera. So I'm looking for ultimate convenience. I want to be able to turn it on and treat it like a point and shoot and get a pretty good image just straight out of the box. And second, I want it to be powerful and reliable for me to be able to use it as a B camera on a professional job, maybe even an A camera. And this just might be the camera that does it all. But let's start with the fun stuff, shall we? 4K, 120 frames per second looks so good. It's nice, it's sharp, it's crisp, it looks awesome. It's amazing to see this kind of picture quality coming out of a small mirrorless camera like this A7S. And if you wanna get really crazy with it, 240 frames per second at 1080p. You definitely notice a little bit of loss in resolution, but it's still plenty usable in my opinion. And at 240 frames per second is where you really start to see all the little details and it almost stops time. You can see every single speckle of dirt flying out. I could think of a million different ways to use this and have fun with it. So that is amazing. I mean, I can't even get that out of this FX9.
Have you guys heard of that thing that people are doing where people jump with a straight face and they land and they film it in slow-mo?
No,
have you seen it?
No.
Oh man, all right, who wants to go first? Little action. I don't think you have enough there.
No,
you probably just went.
Look too good.
And then it comes back up. It goes. Duh, 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 duh.
Dude, I'm so scared.
It's gonna be like the scene in Step Brothers.
Yeah, oh, yeah. Bunk beds, kaboom.
But yeah, I'm officially now vlogging on the A7S Mark III. I have it in S-Log 3 in 10-bit. 422. This mode should give us quite a bit of dynamic range to work with. So I am the shadow, but all this is bright and I should be able to recover a lot of this in post. And all this, the lighting's terrible. There's just shadow and bright areas
And this is really a good test for the dynamic range here.
What is going on? Oh!
And we're back in the studio. The footage you were watching is just S-Log 3, and it just slapped an S-Log 3 LUT on there. It looks pretty good, but of course, we still have a lot of playroom because of this 10-bit. And what I'm really loving is the amount of usable information in the shadows, which is great. When I was color grading this footage, it felt very comfortable. You have space in both the highlights and the shadows to work with. Now, here's a dynamic range comparison against my Canon EOS R. Now, EOS R isn't the newest Canon camera, so this is kind of an unfair comparison, but let's check this out. Here's exposed. Now, let's go a bit underexposed with both cameras here. We're not looking too great. I'm gonna try to bring up the exposure there. We're way under, and it doesn't look great. There's definitely noise here, but we've been able to recover a decent amount of info on Sam here. I'm gonna go ahead and try the same thing in C-Log on the EOS R, and just, yeah, look at that. Not even close. Just look how terrible the Canon EOS R looks in C-Log when I'm trying to recover those shadows. That's one thing I really loved about the A7 S3 was how much detail that you can actually use in there. Like, look at this, it's still noisy, but it looks somewhat okay. On the Canon EOS R, not even close. They both tend to do pretty decent job in the highlights, although the Sony definitely does have an advantage there still. I'll be doing the same exact test on the Canon R5, but I am very, very happy with how much usable dynamic range there is with the Sony A7S. Definitely some of the best footage I've worked with out of a mirrorless camera. Now, I should mention that I have not yet tested the Canon R5. I will be testing that in the coming weeks.
I checked out that footage that you did in the middle of the night, and I was like, what?
Well, hey, that's the low light stuff, okay? Let's check our list of things we need to talk about here. Low light isn't till, oh, actually, that is the next thing we're gonna talk about. See, we got dynamic range, low light next, color science after that, how it's like editing, all that vlog experience. We're going over all that. I try not to care about specs, but there are some things that I do definitely appreciate, like big pixels.
And I cannot lie.
I was gonna go there. See, damn it, Sam, you stole my joke. I wrote it down right here. But 8.5. microns. That's pretty huge.
That is bananas. B-A-N-A-N-A-A.
8.5 microns per pixel. That is great. That's what I want to see. And it's also a backside illuminated sensor. So because of these huge pixels, we're getting way less noise in low light, which means we can blast the ISO, get that crazy low light. So I did a little bit of filming around the campfire with an f/2.8 lens. Shout out to Tamron for hooking me up with some of their lenses. And one, I had no problem with exposure. That fire was plenty to light everything up. Also, the autofocus, even in low light, is pretty good. Now, typically, 12,800 is my limit. I never go past that. And even right there at 12,800, it's pretty noisy and a little bit soft. So I try to avoid it if I can. But that's generally my ceiling. Now, on this A7S, looking at this 12,800 on here, lighting looks pretty good, and you can still see the blues in the sky. I typically turn off log profiles when I get to really extreme low lights, just because cameras tend to do a pretty good job at noise reduction internally.
Like, this is crazy because this is 51,200 ISO, and you know what, it doesn't look as terrible as I would have thought. And I'm just lighting him with my phone light. And check it out. Here's how the iPhone looks with this lighting. You kind of see everyone sitting around the fire. As soon as I pan away, gone. On this camera, it looks beautiful. And you can still see the sky and everything.
Again, this is with an f/2.8 lens, which is a decent fast lens, but there's much faster.
Should be around time for the Milky Way to come out.
Let's see if the camera can see it. I'm at 160,000 ISO. You can kind of see it. Oh man, if I had an f1.4 lens, you would be able to see it.
The low light's all cool and all, but how is it in color?
Are you the transition guy now? Because that's like the next thing on my list right here.
I thought that's what the Sam Cam was for.
Color science is one of those things where it's kind of subjective, right? But in my opinion, they've really made another big push in the right direction. That's one of the hiccups that I've had with the previous A7 models. But at the same time, Sony knows what good color science is, right? Look at their high-end models. Look at the F3, look at the Sony Venice, and this FX9 that we shoot with with all the time. They told me that the S-Log3 is supposed to match the cinema cameras much better, and I can definitely confirm that it's the sensor that just has so much more capability, and those big pixels, man, it makes a big difference. And here you can clearly see it. The issues I used to have with their color science was there's so much magenta in their shadows, that kind of purpley color. I've never been a fan of it. Just like, look at this shot here of Raphael. Look how much more natural he looks there on the left. S-Log profiles are looking so much closer to their cinema cameras than ever before. Now, I still wouldn't say it's as good as their pro level cameras like their Sony FX9, but it's really getting close there. We've done a whole bunch of side-by-side comparisons with this, with the Sony A7S Mark III. So that is dropping tomorrow. So subscribe if you're not already. Now, remember to be careful what you wish for, because once you get higher bitrate, stronger coding, and higher resolution, you're talking about pretty massive file sizes here. So for my vlog channel, I typically care a little bit less about getting that perfect image and care a little bit more about convenience, making it easier to edit, taking up less hard drive space. If that is a concern, there are two settings that I particularly liked. One, I liked shooting in HD, but still using that 10 bit codec. Again, not all HD is created equal. I want good HD. And since it was 10 bit, I was still able to get a lot of dynamic range. If I could choose either have more resolution or better dynamic range, I would always go for better dynamic range. Sam did some tests with the HD in the A7S and also the HD in the A6600. And you saw some improvements?
Yeah, so basically A7S III looks a lot better.
I mean, the colors look better and it just seems to be a sharper, overall better image. So across the board, you're just getting better footage, even if you're not utilizing that 4K. Do you think we're doing a good job at selling the A7S Mark III?
It sells itself, man.
It's a good thing that Sony paid us a bunch of money to promote this camera, huh?
Well, I'm not seeing any of that money, Gene, so.
What are you talking about? They paid us enough to get a 30-day membership to Epidemic Sounds.
Isn't that free?
Yes, link in description for Epidemic Sounds if you want good sound, good music, sound effects, all that good stuff, huh? Epidemic's not even a sponsor. I don't have any sponsors. The other setting I used was also the 60 megabit per second 4K mode. That is not a mode I recommend if you're shooting in S-Log 3, but if the lighting's pretty good, you don't need all that dynamic range. It looks pretty good even at that 60 megabits per second, and you are getting that 4K, you are gonna notice more details, more sharpness. So it's not a bad codec, especially if you don't plan on color grading. There's also H.265 HEVC codecs in here. So if you like to save space, it's an option. Am I getting too technical?
A tad bit.
Let's lighten it up a little bit. Is this a good camera for vloggers? I actually shot most of my camping vlog with it. I'll link it right there. My only issue with it was the stabilization. I felt like it wasn't as smooth as I wanted it to be, but I'm pretty sure that's because I wasn't using a stabilized lens. I know Sony has a 16-35 f4 stabilized lens, and I think that would be the perfect lens for vloggers with this A7S, because you get stabilization in the lens. Then you get IBIS, so that's gonna be another layer of a clean stabilization. On top of that, if you go into steady shot active mode, then you get a 1.1x crop, but it still has enough resolution on that sensor to give you a full 4K image. So it does zoom in a little bit, but gives you another layer of digital stabilization. And I haven't tested it yet, but I honestly think that's probably gonna be the best way to do it, because really, if I could have stabilization anywhere, it would be on a gimbal, right? But if you don't have a gimbal, then it would be in the lens. That's gonna be great. And then you have IBIS, which is awesome. It helps the sensor. It could be used with any lens. But at the same time, if the IBIS is too strong and you're on a wide angle lens, you're gonna get that warpy feeling. I hate that. So I don't want my IBIS to be too strong. And then on top of that, a touch of digital stabilization. Speaking of the digital stabilization or electronic image stabilization, what's great about the A7S's digital stabilization is that it uses gyro information, because there's two ways to stabilize information, right? One is kind of like if you were to use warp stabilizer on Premiere or something like that, where you're analyzing the image and you're tracking with a majority of the screen. Pretty sure that's what this camera does. My issue with that is if I'm zoomed into a dog panting or something like that, where the dog is moving constantly like this, then even if the camera is stable, it's gonna track with it. You've actually done a shoot where it ruined your shoot, right?
Yep. and I had to redo it.
But on the other hand, we have cameras like GoPros, which use gyro information. So it actually knows how the camera was shaking and moving and applies that information into the stabilization. And Sony has confirmed that that is how the digital stabilization works. Again, my vlog, I didn't feel like was as stable as I wanted it to be, but I really want to test it out with that stabilized 16 to 35. And I think that might be the perfect solution because you get stabilized lens, little bit of IBIS, and that digital stabilization that uses that gyro information. So that is definitely a test I will have to do at a later date, but this might be the setup I might go to.
Why are you talking like that?
I don't know. Also, a faster processor, which is across the board gonna be better for you. One benefit is gonna be less rolling shutter. So if you like to do a whole lot of those whip pans, you're gonna appreciate that there's far less rolling shutter. There are certain cameras like the Blackmagic Pocket 6K. Oh, it's a cool camera, but you gotta really be careful with how much foreground stuff you got moving across, you know? All right, let's take a closer look at this thing. It actually feels pretty good in my hands. First of all, we have dual card slots right there, and both of these slots take an SD card as well as a CF Express Type A card. So you could do two CFast Express Type A's or two SD cards or one of each if you want. And there's also a super high resolution viewfinder in here, which will be nice for many. I don't really use the viewfinder that much, but this flip screen is something that we've been needing. And also it's been nice and bright. Even if I'm recording 4K 60, it doesn't dim when I hit record or anything like that. So during my camping trip, I had no issues being able to see the monitor even when it was really bright. So that is a big plus. I really like being able to just tap to focus on the subject. And also, look at this menu, brand new. Something we've been asking for a while, and it's touchscreen. Why isn't it? Oh, touch operation turned off? What the heck? You turned this off, didn't you?
You look like an idiot.
Did you really turn this off?
Yeah.
Why would you do such a thing?
For the content, man. See how funny this bit is?
It's not funny. This is an annoying, and I look stupid. I'm trying to show how you can touchscreen the whole menu. Look at that. It's super nice as long as you don't have someone like Sam going around messing with your settings. That was the worst laugh I've ever heard in my life. The layout feels pretty familiar. You have your C1, 2, 3 custom buttons here, your dials, your joystick, your two down. There's a lot of stuff on here. But as you get more and more familiar with the camera, you start putting in more custom settings. I am loving how there's 1, 2, and 3 memory recall switches. So I have one set to vlog mode where everything's just automatic. We have our mic jack up here, which is nice. It doesn't really get in the way because we plug in microphones all the time. Right below it, headphone jack right there. Below that, look at that, USB-C and micro USB. You could use either or to charge the camera, which is nice. I love that flexibility. USB-C is the way to go. And look at that, full size HDMI. Yes, yes, I love that. I also want to talk about this hot shoe a little bit because, of course, we as vloggers love to mount our mics up here, swing it around, do a little twirl, and then pop it in here. And that's how I have this camera a majority of the time, right? But what I love about Sony's is that this is a multi-interface something, M-I something.
You're just saying letters right now.
But what's cool about that is that there's some microphones where it literally just plugs into there and you don't have to connect it with a cable dangling around and all that. So that's awesome. And even better, there's an attachment that you can throw up here which allows for XLR microphone inputs with phantom power. So basically, this microphone that Sam's using right there, that's a Sennheiser 416. It's a great microphone, but it requires phantom power and XLR inputs for professional microphones. And you can do that on here. So I love that. If you were gonna use this camera as an A cam on like a doc style shoot, that is huge. Should we try to overheat this thing?
Oh yeah.
Let's go. Now Sony's told me that the A7S Mark III has a new cooling system that prevents the camera from overheating as easily. So right now I'm testing that out by recording 4K 24 at 240 megabits per second in 10-bit 422. It's been recording for about 40 minutes straight now and it's actually still doing all right. No sort of warnings or anything like that. And this room is pretty warm. I turned off all the air conditioning, so I'm starting to get a little sweaty, but apparently it's not warm enough. Inside of here is 40 degrees Celsius or around 104 degrees Fahrenheit, basically that tip-top range of the operational temperature. Now it's been recording for 40 minutes straight already, so the camera's already warmed up quite a bit. Let's see how long it lasts once I dump it in here. Looks like we got it to overheat. Now it did last quite a bit of time, but honestly, under normal use, you're probably fine. I would feel
feel totally comfortable using this in most cases. All week I've been filming with it outside and it's been some warm days and I had no issues. And I did also just realize that I can adjust the heat tolerance of this thing. So if I really needed to, I could change that and it would probably last even longer in here. So, not bad, not bad. Ooh, finally done editing this video. Man, there's a lot here, huh? But one thing I do know for sure is that this A7S III kind of has everything I want. I'm gonna go ahead and buy it because I do have to return the version I have. Boo-hoo. I still have to pay full price for it, but I've seen enough to know that it is worth the price, which they just told me is gonna be $34.99. So definitely still not a cheap camera, but I think it's really worth it considering how much capability this camera has. I'll also throw a link down there in the description. If you use that link, costs you the same amount, I get a little kickback, so yay, thanks fam. Also, no record time limit, so as long as you don't run out of power, it doesn't overheat or run out of memory, and you just keep it rolling. Let me know in the comments what else you want to know about this camera. I'll be sure to test it in a later video. And let's wrap this up by reading a few comments from my last video, which is all about the anti-gravity cam. I like whenever Gene sees things that are expensive, he walks away like that. I wish I could walk away from this camera, because I don't need more cameras, because if I buy this camera, I really like it. That means I'm going to start an E-mount lens collection. By the way, all these shots on the A7S were on Tamron lenses. They hooked me up with a lineup, so that was useful for this video. He's more gimbal than man at this point. Gene is also the anti-gravity matter because he's the kid from... Next comment. Imagine your daughter bringing up her boyfriend to the house and you come out with that equipment to greet him. You think he's in Silent Hill. Whenever you guys decide to shoot somewhere, somehow someone finds you and tells you you need a permit. Come to Vermont and New Hampshire and you won't have anyone saying that ever. That is something that does suck about Los Angeles, is if you're trying to film and you have like a big camera, people always kick you out because, you know, there's permits and insurance and all this crap that you need. Honestly, if you drive like 100 miles in any direction of Los Angeles, you're pretty clear, no one cares as much. But that is one of the nice things about the A7S III. I kind of want to get the camera, put a stabilized lens on there, and then put that little XLR adapter thing up top and make it into a tiny little pro camera. You could probably get away with filming with that in LA. Now time to get to the next video where we compare the A7S III to the FX9. Also a couple of ZV-1 shots in there just to get a little more comparison shots. We're gonna try to post that tomorrow, which is actually day after tomorrow from now. But when you watch this, most likely it'll be tomorrow. It's complicated. I'm 12 hours in the future. No, wait, no, I'm in the past, because when you're watching it, this would have happened about 12 hours. Anyways, see you guys tomorrow, maybe. Or maybe if you're watching this way in the future, then it doesn't even matter. Let's just end this here.